Coming up on 60 Minutes, we discuss the dramatic case of Douglas County High School band member and his family, persecuted for not participating in pregame invocations. This is Protestant or Protest on 60 Minutes. Hi, welcome to 60 Minutes. I'm Spencer Hess. Today we will be talking about the Yeager versus Douglas County School District case. Yeager versus Douglas County School District is a 1989 case involving the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment. On one side, a school district is fighting for its rights to perform pregame invocations before athletic events as they have done so since 1947. On the other side, the Yeager family, who feels forced into participation as the minority in a largely Protestant community. An invocation is a traditional prayer used to bless the participants and all those in attendance at athletic events. In the case of Yeager versus Douglas, the invocation is often performed by ministers from the Douglas County Ministerial Association, a Protestant organization. The complaint lies with the Yeager family, who feels that the Protestant invocation infringes on their sincere held beliefs. We spoke with the representatives from both sides of the case in order to further understand the elements of the Establishment Clause. And now we'll take a look at a brief dramatization of what happened.
In Jesus' name we pray!
How can you not participate? Douglas County has always been a Protestant high school.
And now we'll take another look in slow motion.
In Jesus' name we pray!
Wow, that Yeager sure does look disgruntled. Earlier today, we had the chance to catch up with the Yeager family's attorney, Meredith Grimes.
Hi, my name is Meredith Grimes. I represent the Yeager family in Yeager v. Douglas County School District. On June 2nd, 1986, I met with Catherine Sheehane and the Douglas County School attorney, as well as Reverend Jamie E. Jenkins and Donald Mountain. Douglas County proposed two alternative methods to replace the invocation. Either a wholly secular speech with the sole purpose of inspiration, or an equal access plan in which a student, parent, or school staff-led invocation can volunteer.
In response to the Yeager family complaint, school board member Dante Rodriguez had this to say at a press conference earlier today.
After listening to Yeager's concerns about the invocation, the Douglas County School District has decided to pursue an equal access plan, perpetuate and regulate the traditional invocation as part of the opening ceremonies of school athletic event. Our plan specifies that invocation speakers must be randomly selected and that the content of their speeches will not be monitored. Starting on September 26, 1986, all future games will be governed by this equal access plan.
The Yeager family is not happy with the Douglas County School District's decision to pursue an equal access plan. We believe their plan is unconstitutional and violates the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment. The Establishment Clause states that the federal government can neither pass laws which aid one religion, aid all religions, or prefer one religion over another. We believe that the nature of the invocation promotes Christianity over the Yeager family's beliefs.
And now we have Jimmy Jadlos with us here in the studio, the judge that presides over the Yeager family's appeal. Jimmy, what did the court ultimately decide after the appeal?
So the court applied the Lemon Test in order to determine the legality of the invocation. As applied, the invocation clearly does not have a secular purpose, since the school districts refused to try the purely inspirational speech.
And how did the school district justify the religious aspect of the invocation?
The school district cited Marsh v. Chambers, in which the Supreme Court upheld Nebraska's practice of commencing state legislative sessions with a prayer delivered by a chaplain employed by the state.
And does this case hold precedent in the Yeager versus Douglas case?
No, it does not, because Marsh was based on more than 200 years of unique history of legislative invocations. It has no application to the case. This practice existed at a time when high school sports did not exist. Therefore, the Lemon Test is the only guide to the court's analysis.
Welcome back to 60 Minutes. We're still here with Jimmy. Can you expand further on the Lemon Test?
Certainly. The first prong of the Lemon Test asks whether the challenged practice had a secular purpose. In applying the purpose test, it is clear that the proposed Equal Action Plan perpetuates and endorses the Protestant faith.
How exactly does the invocation endorse religion?
The court found that the invocation serves four purposes: to continue a long-standing custom and tradition, to add a solemn and dignified tone to the proceeding, to remind the spectators and players of the importance of sportsmanship and fair play, and to satisfy the genuine good faith wishes on the part of a majority of the citizens of Douglas County to publicly express support for Protestantism. By rejecting the inspirational speech, Douglas County has made that last point especially clear.
So at this point, does Douglas County have a case?
No. Even if the invocation passed the first prong of the lemon test, it fails the primary effects prong as well by placing those in attendance at athletic events in the position of participating in a group prayer.
Thank you so much, Jimmy. In the end, the Douglas County School District was forced to cease the invocations and also pay attorney fees to the Yeager family, a classic lose-lose situation. This is Spencer Hess, and you've been watching 60 Minutes.
The school district argues that since the invocation is outside the instructional environment of the classroom, the invocation is not school-sponsored. What is the merit of this argument?
Even though not occurring in a classroom, the invocations take place at a school-owned stadium during a school-sponsored event. In Doe versus Aldean, Indiana School District, the United States District Court for the Southern District of Texas rejected the argument that the school district asserts here. In Doe, a public high school sponsored extracurricular activities at which a prayer was sung. The defendants argued that the prayer did not violate the Establishment Clause because it occurred outside the classroom. The Doe court rejected this argument. Their reasoning was that because these extracurricular activities provided a powerful incentive for students to attend and were school sponsored and so closely identified with the school program, the fact that the religious activity took place in a non-religious setting might create in a student's mind the impression that the state's attitude toward religion lacks neutrality. The Doe's court reasoning applies equally well in the present case.
The equal access plan proposed by the Douglas County School District would allow for teachers to volunteer to deliver the invocation. Is there a teacher-student relationship during staff-led invocations that would violate the Establishment Clause? Since the Equal Access Plan does permit teachers to deliver religious invocations, a teacher-student relationship is created. Furthermore, to persons of any age who do not believe in prayer, religious invocations permitted by the Equal Access Plan convey the message that the state endorses religions believing in prayer and denigrates those religions that do not. If these prayers are delivered by authority figures, such as teachers, as is possible under the Equal Access Plan, the message endorsing prayer becomes even stronger.
The school district argues that since attendance at football games is voluntary, there is no constitutional violations. What is the merit of this argument? This argument does not hold up. Whether the complaining individual's presence was voluntary is not relevant to the Establishment Clause analysis. The Establishment Clause focuses on the constitutionality of the state action, not on the choices made by the complaining individual.
The school district's last argument is that if there is a violation, it is a de minimis violation of the Establishment Clause. What does this mean and why should it matter? A de minimis violation of the Establishment Clause is the least serious offense. However, even though the invocations are only about 60 to 90 seconds, they are still encroachments on the First Amendment. The Establishment Clause does not focus on the amount of time an activity takes, but rather the religious character of the activity.